carry the burden for too long on mine. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. Yeah, I see it now, I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you. We've all had moments during the pandemic of questioning things, the validity of our priorities, the goodness of our friendships and relationships, even the purpose of our lives and of suffering in this world. And even though this questioning feels really heavy at times, these are moments of great blessing. We are supposed to be asking these questions. Today, let's take a break from distracting ourselves with other things and other people. This time we have together is a blessing on the journey of understanding who we are and why we are here, our vocation.
You saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your song for redemption, the price for my heart. And I don't have a contact for that kind of love. I don't understand, I can't comprehend, but all I know is I need you. I run to the fire.
Here's the other great blessing. You are never alone on this journey. God and all the saints are cheering you on. The saints, in particular, show us the amazing things that God can do through us, even in all our human weakness. For this reason, in the midst of the pandemic, Pope Francis declared this year as the year of Saint Joseph, giving us a guide to follow through this time of challenge and change. Today, we will reflect on our own vocation by journeying with Saint Joseph on this, his feast day. God is always reaching out to us through his saints and also through good people here on earth who use their lives to serve with love. Today we're blessed to have one of those people with us. His name is Father Matt McCarthy. He grew up in Brampton, attended university and seminary in Toronto, and was ordained to the priesthood in 2017. In addition to being a talented athlete and musician, Father Matt has long been known for his beautiful ability to journey with young people through youth ministry, even before he was an ordained priest. Today he serves as a director of the Office of Vocations, where his primary mission is to continue that journey, guiding young men and women who feel called to the vocation of priesthood or religious life through spiritual direction, retreats, and talks. Although his current mission is very specific, he has a lot of wisdom to offer all of us in our vocations, regardless of what they are. He kindly made time to answer questions on this topic from some of our students recently, And we're excited to share some excerpts of that conversation with you today.
Academy, Father Matt, we're so happy to have you here today. In anticipation of your visit, we asked a group of students to share questions that they have about vocations. And we're so thankful to them because they really opened up their hearts and dug deep to ask a lot of questions that I think probably all of us have along the journey of life. And so today we have a small group of students with us from Student Leaders at McGiveMe. And they have been gracious enough to go on camera, which no one wants to do anymore, to bring those questions from their peers to you. So, yeah, without any further ado, I'm going to pass it on to our first student.
Awesome. Thank you, Ms. Selvakumar. So my name is Sook, and I'm a grade 11 student, Father Matt. So I'm so happy that you're here with us today. So pretty much the first question that the students have posed and that I'm going to be posing to you today is, so first, can you help us understand the definition of a vocation and how the church defines it?
Sure. Yeah. First of all, great to meet all of you. Thank you, Ms. Selvakumar, for inviting me to be with you. It's a really good privilege to be speaking to students again. It's rare nowadays that, you know, well, first of all, it's impossible, really next to impossible to just go into a school and have a chat with students. So this is the next best thing. And it's great to be with you. And Sook, thank you for your question regarding vocation, how the church defines vocation. So you probably have talked about this in some of your classes before, but the word vocation comes from the Latin word vocare, which is a Latin word meaning call. So that's what a vocation is. It's a call. It's a calling. This is where we get the idea of having a calling to do something specific. If that language kind of is a little foreign to you, the language I like to use of vocation is mission. Everyone's got a mission. That is specifically chosen for you. And from the Christian perspective, every baptized Christian, from the moment of their baptism, because baptism is not only a sacrament where you become a child of God in a formal sense, but baptism is a mission-granting ceremony. That's where you receive your mission. Now, most Catholics and Christians were baptized as infants, so they received their mission in a seedling form. But we all have one. It's a mission, and it's a God-given mission that takes into account your gifts, your talents, your weaknesses. You know, I prefer to look at it this way. So everyone is a puzzle piece. And think of, I guess, the parts jutting out of a puzzle as your strengths and the indents as your weaknesses. Well, every puzzle piece fits into a slot. So God has made you with a particular package. Strengths and weaknesses, and he's not turned off by the weaknesses, by the way, all for the purpose of fitting into a slot, you know. And the example I like to use is, because I'm a basketball fan, Kawhi Leonard. He's got massive hands. I don't know if you knew that, but he's got one of the biggest hands ever in the NBA. As a child, if he tried to make it as a cellist or a violin player, he probably wouldn't, right? He'd probably get really frustrated. But that limitation in terms of playing the cello gives him one of the greatest advantages as an NBA player. And couple that with, you know, his perfect size, his, you know, athletic build, one of the best players in the NBA, right? So God's made all of us as a puzzle piece with a certain set of gifts and talents. And part of life, part of my job as vocation director is helping people discern or to figure out what that mission is. And just speaking from experience, there's nothing more freeing, there's nothing more exciting than knowing what that mission is and embracing it. And it's not gonna be easy. Every vocation is gonna require, it's gonna cost you everything you got, basically. Right?
That was amazing. Thank you so, so much for that. So I think like the last question that people have posed for us today is, in terms of vocations, is can everyone find love? Does everyone have the ability or the capability of finding love?
Yeah, great question. You see, in English, we got one word for love, and we use it to describe our feelings about anything from vanilla ice cream, which I love, but unfortunately I can't eat now because I'm getting more intolerant as you get older, kind of thing. One of the sacrifices of life. Or you can use it to talk about your mother, you know, or your spouse. So, you know, you could say, I love the Toronto Raptors. And later that evening on Mother's Day, I could say, Mom, I love you. I'm using the same word, right? Love. But I mean two totally different things. If I meant the same thing, if I love my mom the same way I love the Toronto Raptors, I'm in trouble, okay? That's not good for my mom. That's a lot of disrespect right there. I mean, I love the Toronto Raptors and everything, but my mom is just, you know, is a person deserving of love. The Greeks, the ancient Greeks had four words for love, okay? So there's Eros love, which is what we usually associate with love, the heart kind of, you know, on the Valentine's Day card, that type of love. Powerful, strong, it's very emotion-based, it's God-given. Storge is family love. It's love between, you know, mom and kids and dads and brothers and sisters and stuff like that, right? I've got sisters and I love them. And even though at times they were, how do I put it? Sometimes they annoyed me, all right? Even now, I still love them. They're my sisters, doesn't change that. Storge, that's what that type of love is. Philia is like buddy love, friendship love. You know, so you see like Ronaldo and Messi giving a hand clasp before they play, you know, the Champions League game. They're buddies, right? It's like a brotherly love from another mother kind of thing. Brother from another, that kind of love. Fourth type of love, most important type of love, right? I'd say the highest form is agape, A-G-A-P-E. And the best Christian depiction of that is Christ on the cross. It's the type of love that says, I don't care what you do to me. I don't care if you turn your back on me. I don't care if you crucify me. I'm going to come at you with love. I will the best for you. I want the best for you, despite the fact that you're not treating me well right now. That's tough. It's hard to do. But Christ gives us the example. And that's what the cross really represents. Here's where I'm going with this. You might not have the opportunity to exercise storge love, so family love. I mean, there's orphans out there who don't have family love. You might not have the opportunity to exercise eros love, like the romantic, you know, bachelor, bachelorette kind of love. You might not have the opportunity to exercise philia or buddy love. I don't know. Let's say you're on a desert island. I don't know. Or everyone around you is an enemy. But everyone can have the opportunity of exercising agape love. And that's what fulfills you. Every other love comes and goes. But living like Christ, saying, I'm going to come at you with love, even though you know, I'm going to sacrifice for you, despite the fact that you hate me right now, that can be exercised anytime. It's a hard type of love, but it's the way to go. It's what we're wired to do. And I'll revert back to my last answer. My aunt, right? Her whole motto was, how can I give of myself? That's agape love. If you look for opportunities to exercise agape love, doesn't matter who you are, gay, straight, man, woman, priest, husband, wife, whatever. If you're exercising agape love, it's hard, but you're going to find the meaning of life in that very act.
Thank you so much for that. I am so appreciative. Like, it has put so many things into perspective for me. Like, I have learned so much from just this, like, this little 5-minute conversation we've had.
Thank you, Father Matt, for that amazing response. You really, again, like Sook said, put so many things in perspective, and like what you said, what can be applied in our lives like every single day. And like, it's very important of the things that you said. Kailash, I'm a grade 11 student and I'm also a big basketball fan like you. And my question—
Not after last night though, not after last night. I'm kind of—
Oh my God.
Watching the Leafs now, yeah. So.
And my question to you is, one challenge right now for young people in terms of finding their place is struggling with the pandemic. And it's raising a lot of questions about what is the point of like working so hard in school and life when we're so flawed, or the world is so flawed?
Yeah, let's make no mistake. So what we're doing, what we're living through right now, and I'm using sort of the buzzword that's kind of overplayed now, is unprecedented. You know, this is the biggest thing that will probably ever happen in our lives, hopefully, knock on wood, you know, hopefully it doesn't get worse, but this is pretty huge what we're living through right now. And it's causing a lot of people, a lot of just normal people, to go bananas right now. And I don't mean that to, you know, to denigrate anybody. It's just, man, we're not meant to live like this. We're not meant to be cut off from people. You know, we're social as human beings. We're social animals. We're social by nature, and more so, we're physically social by nature. So doing this whole virtual thing, it's a supplement, but nothing more. You know, we don't have relationships with pixels. We have relationships with real people. You know, that's how we're built. That's how we're meant to be. So we're all, for all intents and purposes, cut off from that. So it's tough, absolutely. So some of the questions that might come to mind are, so what's the point? What's the point? What's the point in studying so hard? What's the point in working so hard? Great questions. And again, I'm going to revert back to the lens that my aunt uses. My motto is, how can I make of myself a gift for another person? That can be done in a pandemic. It's not easy. Let's make no mistake. Like, it's not pleasurable to go outside of yourself and live for another person, right? But somehow, this is why Jesus in the gospel says, those who wish to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. He's not talking about, you know, jumping off a bridge. He's talking about losing your life in the sense of giving it away as a gift. In that action, you will find it. You will find the authentic meaning of life, regardless of what your vocation is. So that puts some meaning to, you know, to the question, what's the meaning in life? You know, I've come to realize that everything a person does matters. Every little thing that a person does matters. And here's why. I was listening to a lecture one time, and this guy was saying, we're all like, you see, if you have this outlook on life, like you're just a little speck of dust amongst a billion specks of dust, yes, you will have mental health issues. You will despair. You will think, what's the point? But think of yourself as a node in a network. You know how a node in a network works, right? Like everyone on social media, just for the sake of argument, is connected to like 1,000 people. Those 1,000 people are connected to tens of thousands of people. You know, so you're like 2 people away from a billion people, like literally, you know? We're connected. And everything we do, especially now with social media, everything we do has an effect on the world around us. So don't underestimate any little small act of charity that you do. Here's an example of this. I heard this on Twitter the other day. So you're a basketball fan, right? I don't know if you know Caris LeVert. He played for the Brooklyn Nets, but now plays for what is it? Indiana Pacers.
Pacers, yeah.
He had a heart condition, right? He had a kidney condition. And that was only found out when he got traded, because when you get traded, you have to do all these tests, these physical tests. And it was a life-threatening thing. Well, that would have only happened if he got traded. How did he get traded? Something else happened. And then something else happened. It's like a domino effect. And someone tracked it back to, I don't know how this happened, to Damian Lillard's game-winning shot against Paul George in the finals. And so, you know, someone was upset, so he wanted to trade. And so that was the first domino that fell. And then the next domino that fell. So ultimately, Caris LeVert got traded. And if he didn't, he might not be here today, or he might be in serious condition. So what I'm saying is everything we do matters. So if we're tempted to think, what's the point? You know, it's tempting to think that. But the reality is everything we do matters.
So hi, Father Matt. It's really nice to meet you. My name is Shweta, and I am a grade 12 student at McGivney. And so my question actually kind of builds on Kailash's question a little bit. And it's basically like, apart from the pandemic, we know that there are many young individuals who struggle with their faith lives and their perceptions of religion, you know, whether that's, you know, they just don't believe in God, or maybe they struggle with certain aspects of religion, or maybe it's even peer pressure, you know, like their friends are atheists, so they feel like they have to be as well, and they feel like their belief in God might be kind of invalid. So my question to you is, what would you say to these people, and how can we grow in our faith lives?
it helps to know that Christianity and practicing, like Christianity in general, following Jesus, following the truth, really, because that's what he claimed about himself, following the truth, that was never meant to be an in thing. You know, it's always going to be met with resistance. So I think the sooner we all come to accept the fact that this is how kind of life, how this is kind of how life goes. You follow Christ, you give your life for him, you follow the truth, it's going to be met with resistance. So just first of all, it helps to know that, right? To know that you're not living out of the ordinary here. Like you're not specifically, you know, the universe didn't conspire to produce, you know, you particularly victimized you. Like there's a lot of people in this situation, you know? So it helps to know that. I think one of the things that helps in these times is also realizing what we're in, what kind of an environment we're in. In the Bible, the ancient Israelites were taken to a desert. So they were enslaved to the Egyptians. God, through the prophet Moses, brought them into the desert. He brought them into the promised land eventually, but they spent 40 years in a desert. What's in a desert? Nothing. That's the definition of a desert. Why did God bring them into a desert? Well, a desert, spiritually speaking, is a place where we're faced with nothing but God. You know, sometimes finding God is not so much a process of locating him, but it's a process of cutting away all the things that's not him and cutting away all the things that ultimately don't lead to him. So I love social media. I mean, we're making use of it right now. We will be in the future, right? But over the past year, I've really limited my use of it. And I can tell you, it's done wonders for my relationship with the Lord, let alone my mental health, right? First of all, I see myself more as God sees me and not how others see me. And it helps in not comparing myself to others, which is a temptation. It's like candy. Yeah, we want to compare ourselves to others, but in the long run, it's not very helpful. So you'd be surprised. And I'll go back to this whole idea of taking small steps. You know, I think we get in trouble if we think that the first step we have to take is too insurmountable and is too above us. Start small, take little concrete steps, and they can pay huge dividends. So yeah, this is a period where we're in a desert, and as unpleasant as the desert is, biblically speaking, it's the location that God has chosen to reveal himself and for us to get a better understanding of who he is. It's not a pleasant place because we don't like having things stripped away. We don't like having our little crutches or whatever we're leaning on that's not God. We don't like those things, you know, kicked out from under us. But in some ways, it's necessary. So it's a painful time. Lent, we're in the season of Lent. This is why people give stuff up, you know, to sort of throw away those what we formerly relied on, you know, and maybe things that we thought, you know, they're so important that we wake up in the morning for this reason, right? No, let's give those things up because as great as those things are, they're not God, right? And so that's what a desert does. It's a painful place, a trying place, but in some ways a necessary place. So again, it just helps to know, first of all, that life is like this. If you commit yourself to following Christ, to living out your faith, it's going to be met with resistance. And come to accept the fact also that what we're in right now is kind of a desert. Mm-hmm. And by the way, one last thing. Speaking of doubting God and, you know, having an intellectual battle over these questions, the name of God in the Bible of God's chosen people is Israel. The name Israel literally means one who wrestles with God. So in a sense, having a wrestling match with God is somehow inherent in our religion. So there is space in our relationship with God for a wrestling match. And by that, I mean, you know, struggling, you know, having doubts. So I think the important thing is to continue the struggle, you know, having the goal that I'm no longer going to have any doubts or any questions. You can try and have those questions answered, but there's always going to be something that mystifies you. What I think the virtuous thing is just to keep struggling, keep struggling and know that God is not, he's willing to have a wrestling match. Like it's not disrespectful. You know, you're not being like, oh, I don't know, God, am I allowed to question this? Am I allowed to, you know, doubt? No, he just wants to hear from you. He wants to hear from you. God.
And so building upon that idea of like struggles with faith, like there's also a struggle with the ritualistic aspects of religion. So for example, a lot of students have been mentioning that they believe in God and they don't have that much struggle with their internal belief, but they struggle with the idea of religion or organized religion in a sense. So for example, they feel like religions have laws and rules that they can't live up to and all these expectations. And so they might not agree with every practice or ritual. And as a result, they automatically feel like they also can't be part of a religion. And so that's what my question is to you is what would you say to students who are struggling with this ritualistic aspect of religion?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, great question. And that is a perennial, like it's as old as scripture itself. Like the Pharisees in the Bible, you know, made a God out of the rules, you know, and Jesus called them out on that. So this goes right back even to scripture, even to the gospel. So Christ is well aware of the tension between the rules of a religion and the religion itself. So here's another kind of image that I'll use. I use a lot of sporting images, so hopefully I'm not, you know, ostracizing too many people or, you know, but hopefully this makes sense. So like I mentioned, I'm a basketball fan. The NBA has a thick rule book, right? Full of rules, right? If I wanted to get someone to love basketball as much as I do, what wouldn't I do? I would not hand that person the rule book, say, read this, memorize it, take it to heart. You're going to write an exam on this in a few months. And by the end of that experience, you're going to love basketball as much as I will. It's just not going to work. We know that's not going to work. What would I do to get a person to love basketball as much as I would? If I were a millionaire, I'd take them courtside. I would take them to a game and have them experience the game in all of its beauty, in all of its wonder, in all of its athleticism, the quickness, the pace. Man, it's amazing. Now, the rules are important for the purpose of having the game be what it is, but the rules are not the game. And this is where people get tripped up, confusing the rules for the game. If there were no rules, things would just devolve into chaos. Have you ever seen a bunch of kindergarten kids play their own version of basketball? It's pretty funny, but then it gets kind of dangerous because kids are just making up their own rules. They're just doing whatever. So it might be fun for a while, but it really ends up in a bad, it can end up in a bad place.
So hi, I'm Arden. I'm in grade 10. And my question is, because many students struggle with the way they see themselves, for example, insecurities, lack of skill and confidence, and this prevents them from pursuing and living out their hopes and dreams. So what would you say to students who feel like they're failing and are asking if they know they're a good person?
There's a battle, like I'm speaking as a priest now, for obvious reasons from my perspective. So take it what you will, but there's a battle going on all the time for our souls. You know, there's a good side and a bad side. The voice of God, so not again, not the audible voice. I've actually never heard God's voice. I don't know what it sounds like. So let me know if you've heard what his voice sounds like. But I'm saying the flavor of the voice that God has is to say, look, you're my child, okay? That's the most fundamental identity you have, is you're my child, you're mine to love, you're mine to protect. Nothing will change that. You know, you can mess up, you can screw up, nothing's changing the fact that you're my child. There's another side that's trying to drown out that, not only trying to drown out that, but trying to make you feel like trash. Okay, so in Christianity, the evil one, his name is Satan. I don't know what it is in Arabic, Shaitan or something like that. But anyways, the name Satan literally means one who accuses. Accusatory voices. You hear that? And they're real voices, man. Trust me. Trust me. People hear those things or they feel them. At least you know where they're coming from and where they're not coming from, okay? So they're not coming from God. They're coming from the accuser. which is his role, is to point the finger. If you feel like someone's pointing the finger at you all the time, it's tempting to think, okay, that might be coming from God, because it's a strong feeling. But just know we're in a spiritual battle, and it's a tactic that the enemy uses all the time. Right? So, you're a child of God, a loved child of God, and nothing you could do or don't do can change that. Question, Arden?
Hi, Father. My name is Sarah.
Hi.
I'm a grade 11 student here at McGiffney. So the questions I had was, so a lot of people are wondering, how did you personally find your vocation? What were some of the challenges you faced discerning it? And how did you know specifically that you wanted to become a priest and not just like a monk or a brother?
Yeah, there's a lot to that question. And I could start anywhere with this. I can go way back to when I was a kid. But growing up, you know, I was involved in church. I was involved in my faith. I had a good education, upbringing. Both parents were great, you know. Very often it's said that a person's first perception of God comes from their parents. So a little child will project the image of their parents onto God. Psychologically speaking, that's what happens. And so I had very good parents. So I had a very good image of God. I was an altar server at Mass, which is the guy that helps the priest, you know, serve Mass. But I never seriously considered a vocation of the priesthood until much later, until I was in university. I mean, the question of being a priest was always in the back of my mind, but I wanted to do other things, other more what I thought were exciting things with my life at the time. But it was only in university, really, when I had met a priest for the first time who really opened my eyes to the beauty of the vocation of the priesthood. First of all, he was a little younger than most priests that I had met growing up. Most priests that I had met, all of the priests growing up that I met growing up, were excellent priests. They loved what they did. They made gifts of themselves for others. But they were always older. Like, they were always the grandfather figure in my life. And so I respected what they did. But I was like, I can't see myself doing that. Like, that's for older people, right? Grandfather type figures. So when I was in university, the chaplain of my university was a younger guy, just had a lot of the same interests that we students had. And I was like, and this guy was happy. He was genuinely happy. Like, it's like my aunt, you know, I was talking about earlier. He was genuinely happy despite the fact that he didn't have a lot of the things that the world says a person needs to have in order to be happy. You know, so he didn't have his own family. He didn't have a, you know, fancy car. He didn't take exotic vacations multiple times a year. Not that there's anything wrong with that. It's just, it wasn't part of his lifestyle. It wasn't part of his ethos. He was living very simply, very humbly, and yet one of the most genuinely happy people that I know. So I thought, hey, wait a second. If he's happy doing this, is it possible that this could work out for me as well? So that's sort of where the conversation in my head went. And, so I didn't go to the seminary to study to be a priest right away after meeting this guy. I tried other things in my life. I tried, different careers. I was in a relationship for a while, wanting to, you know, hoping that my vocation was to vocation of marriage. But at the end of the day, the thought of the priesthood and in living my life in service as a priest, particularly as a priest, that's what gave me the most peace. That's what gave me the most, like, yes, this is where I'm being led. It feels like home, you know? I felt a sense of peace about being a priest. And what's interesting is that I didn't want to feel a sense of peace about being a priest. I wanted to be at peace in the relationship, you know, at marriage. But if I was honest with myself, I would have to say, this is not where it's at. I think if I'm honest with myself, priesthood is what gives me the greatest sense of meaning and purpose and peace.
Thank you. So just another quick question. What are like some of the challenges and the joys and the struggles that you find now as living as a priest?
Yeah, well, I mean, on a very natural level, I have a longing for family, like my own family, and to have a wife and a family. I mean, those are natural goods. You know, we're meant for relationships. So there's that. but I have to say it doesn't disturb the peace that I have, like the deep down, like on one level of myself, like a more superficial level, not that it's superficial, like it's merely superficial, but there's a level of me that still yearns for, you know, like a career, a job, a wife and a kid. But on the deepest level, the core is doing what I'm doing right now. So that helps when sort of the difficult times come and I'm sort of, you know, thinking about how the grass might be greener on the other side of the fence, so to speak, you know. So that can be a struggle. But again, it hasn't really disturbed the peace that I have deep down in the core of me. There's a lot of other, like right now we're all struggling, you know, in this pandemic, and priests are meant to be with people. Like we're meant to model ourselves after Christ, and he was with people, and this is just not really happening now. You know, masses aren't happening, you know. And you know, for possibly good reasons of keeping in mind the health of other people. So I get it, you know, but it still sucks, the fact that.
Hello, Father Matt. My name is Garen. I'm a grade 10 student, and my question kind of builds on Sarah's question. It's, what if your family or your school life or just the circumstance that you're in is dictating a particular path to you, but you don't think that this is your call?
Yeah, that's a tough one. Garen, I know in my circumstance, most people in my family don't get why I'm a priest. You know, so a lot of them are Catholic. They respect priests, but they just don't get why I chose to be a priest. But I'm lucky in the sense that none of them are really hostile to what I'm doing. I might get some weird looks, you know, but nothing really bad, you know. And I've seen that unfortunately happen in some priests' lives, you know. So I would say the first thing, and this kind of goes back to something I was saying before, is just know that you're not alone, you know, like this. Whatever vocation you're ultimately called to, again, will be met with resistance. Every authentic vocation, on the whole, it should make the world around you a better place, but there's always going to be a select few people that will try to make things difficult for you. Look at Jesus. There's a part in the Bible where his own family members, so not Mary and Joseph, but his extended family, his hometown, which is basically your extended family, they wanted to throw him off a cliff. Literally, they wanted to toss him off a cliff. They didn't manage to do that, but the point is, you know, Jesus was the most true person who ever lived, and yet there were people who wanted to throw him off a cliff, right? So the point is, again, every authentic vocation will be met with some resistance, either from family, friends, you know, and that's kind of a constant in life, just generally speaking, you know? So sometimes life is the great art of being able to do what you're called to do and just manage the naysayers. You know, and to do so in a professional way, so not in an arrogant way, not a sticking it in your face kind of a way, not a like, I'm doing this and there's nothing, like, okay, like, let's stop. We can do without the dramatics, right? But just to go about and say, okay, I respect your decisions, everyone, but this is what I believe my call is. And in being truthful with myself, I have to continue on this sacrifice. You know, we don't get not to sacrifice. You know, the question shouldn't be, how do I get out of making a sacrifice in my life? What am I going to do with my life that gets me out of uncomfortable situations? You know, that's the wrong question. The question should be, what kind of a sacrifice am I gonna make? How am I gonna sacrifice? What yoke best fits my shoulders? You know, the yoke, they're pulled by like oxen, right? What yoke best fits my shoulders so I can pull? We don't get not to carry a yoke or to pull a yoke. That's not an option. We have to carry a yoke, but there's a yoke that's most suited for your shoulders. Right, so to speak. So pray and then decide. Make a decision and see what happens. Don't be afraid of making the wrong decision, because one of the best pieces of advice that I've received, just from a human point of view, is that the baseline of life is failure. So don't be afraid of failing, because it's like, that's how all greatness starts. You try a bunch of things and you fail at them. It sucks. It's hard. It's going to be hard on us, and it, you know, might cause some pain, but that's kind of like the norm. You know, when you're first trying things out, you're going to stumble and fall. But decide, make a decision, move in a direction. You know, there's a saying that goes, God can't steer a boat that's tied to the dock. So, I mean, you could pray all you want. You could make pros and cons to till you die, literally. But if you don't untie your boat and just set out on a path, God can't steer you, you know? So make a decision, make an informed decision. It shouldn't be just like, okay, you know, to heck with it. I'm going to spin the globe and I'm going to go there. Or I'm going to just randomly choose. No, make an informed decision. Make a decision though, you know? Date the person, you know, if you feel called to marriage. I feel it's kind of funny. People will tell me, Father, I feel called to marriage. All right, who are you dating? Well, there's no one in my life right now. It's like, well, I mean, marriage is to a person, right? It's not marriage in general. It's marriage to a person, right? So go on a date, see if it works out. If you feel called to the priesthood or religious life, go to a seminary, check it out. Go on a come and see weekend. Go to a convent, you know, try on the suit to see if it fits is another image, you know? So make a decision, go somewhere, do something and just be open for the guidance of God. And then don't worry, you know, don't beat yourself over the head if you're making mistakes or you're failing. Cause again, that's kind of the baseline. So pray, decide, and don't worry.
Hi, Father Matt. My name is Jackie and I'm in grade 10 here at FMM. So my question relates to Garen's question about our paths and vocations. And it's, what advice do you have for students in terms of figuring out or discerning their own vocations?
Yeah, so a large part of this, I guess, will revert to what I said to Galen a little while ago. You know, pray, decide, don't worry. What practical steps can you take? Here's something that a priest told me a little while ago that might help, especially if you're Catholic, if anyone's Catholic. But not just Catholic, really. Like, this can apply to everyone. He told me that a spiritual director that he once had, so a spiritual director is kind of like a mentor, someone you can go to and just, you know, get some advice. The wise old sage kind of a figure, but it doesn't have to be an old person. It can just be someone who you know, is mentoring you, or who you consider to be a mentor. An old spiritual director once told this guy, he said, you know, a lot of guys come to me asking me, what's God calling me to do, Father? I'm feeling so confused. You know what he would tell those guys? Is he would tell them, go home for a while and spend some time getting a good grasp of the sin problem in your life. Okay, we all know what sin is, right? If you don't like the word sin, think of it this way. What dumb things am I doing on a regular basis that I know are dumb, but because I'm of human weakness, which we all have, I just keep doing, right? What are those things? Try to get a handle of those, okay? So a good goal is not to necessarily get rid of all of them, because that's not going to happen this side of heaven. We're all sinners. We're going to fall. We're going to sin time and again. But getting a good grasp of it, right? Being honest with yourself. So these guys would do that for a couple of weeks or 3 weeks or whatever, and then they'd go back to this spiritual director, and they'd say, you know, Father, I have a better idea of what God is asking me to do. And the reason is because sin, or the habit of sin, or those dumb things we know we're dumb, but we just continue doing because we're weak, those things cloud our decision-making capabilities. It's like it fogs the vision, right? That if sin has a clouding effect on the mind. It's, for example, it's rare that a guy would binge on McDonald's or stream movies for hours on end, and at the end of that would say, I'm going to go build some low-income housing now. Like, I'm just ready to do good stuff. That, like, doesn't happen. So getting a good grasp of those things is a good, I would say, secret tool to use when figuring out what your vocation is, you know? So yeah, that's what I would say, just to build on the answer I gave to Garen.
Yes, thank you so much, Father Matt, for sharing your insight and wisdom. I was also wondering if you could expand or clarify on how we can properly interpret God's calling, because He doesn't just leave a voicemail for us and tell us what to do with our lives. Also, when will we know?
Yeah, you're right in that He doesn't make it really obvious. I didn't get an email. I didn't get a phone call from God. What I did though, is I had to be honest and just sort of take a look at what's happening around me. You know, some people might have said, you know, you should think about being a priest. You know, and at the time I was like, yeah, whatever, I'm gonna do what I want. But you know, these were smart people. It's not like they were, you know, they had some sort of ulterior motive in hinting at me that I was to be a priest. So yes, keeping an ear to the ground, You know, God speaks, yes, he speaks through our hearts, but he also speaks in the environment around us, you know? And I wish I could tell you it's easy. It's as easy as that, but it's a process. It really is a process. And looking back, I can say, I'm thankful it was a process. I'm thankful God did not send me an email and say, this is what you're going to be doing with your life. First of all, that would really limit my freedom. God made us free. He wants us to use our freedom to choose what he wants for us. He didn't program us to be, you know, like robots saying, you know, I love you, I will do this. No, you know, he has a plan for us, but he wants us to use our freedom to choose it or not choose it, you know? So it's a process of using our freedom to know what God's will is for us. And like I say, it was a process because if I knew maybe like 10 years ago or maybe 15 years ago that I was supposed to be a priest, I would have, there's so many things that I learned in the process about myself in being confused about my vocation that I would never have learned if I knew exactly what I was supposed to do 15 years ago. You know, I needed to go through a time of making mistakes and going to where I thought God was calling me to be, but it didn't turn out to be that. And was it painful in a sense? Yeah, it was. But looking back now, I can say that I'm wiser for them. You know, I know more things now than I would have if I didn't get involved in some of those things. So it all works. It all works out. You know, I had a prayer experience one time. This is one of the most real things that I have experienced. But I remember just sitting in church one time. And I remember this is inception sort of thing, right? So just kind of bear with me a little bit. It might get confusing. But I just sensed I was about to make a decision with my life that I deep down knew was not the right decision. It wasn't a wrong decision. It wasn't like a sinful decision. But I just knew it wasn't what, if I was honest with myself. But I said, I'm just going to go for it. I remember not hearing a voice in my head, but just this feeling inside of me, a very consoling feeling. It was almost as if God was saying, I'm still going to be here, Matt. I'm still going to be here. You know, I ugly cried that day because I don't know. It's just a real, I can't even explain it more than that. But I just remember having that feeling like God was saying, no matter what you choose, Matt, I'm still going to be here for you. So I ended up going my way, what I thought was the way. It wasn't the way, you know, that God wanted for me. But I learned so much in the process, and God was very gentle with me, I have to say. And he will be with you as well.
So Father Matt, those are all our questions for you today. So thank you so, so much for taking the time to answer the student questions. You've provided a lot of insight and vocational guidance, so thank you. You've given us a lot to reflect on and pray with as we enter into this time of prayer together. So thank you again.
Great. Okay. Thanks, Krista.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, as we gather on the feast of Saint Joseph, allow the example of this great saint to influence our lives and guide our vocations. May this time of prayer open our hearts to your voice, so that we can more clearly hear how much you love us and how much you desire for us. Through the example and intercession of Saint Joseph, help us to grow in faithfulness, honor, integrity, justice, humility, and service, so that we too can do great things in you. Amen.
Reading from the second book of Samuel. The word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, when your time comes and you rest with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come forth from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me. Your house and your kingdom shall endure forever before me." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I will sing of your steadfast love, O Lord, forever. With my mouth, I will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations. I declare that your steadfast love is established forever. Your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. His line shall continue forever.
You said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to my servant David. I will establish your descendants forever and build your throne for all generations. His line shall continue forever.
He shall cry to me, you are my father, my God, and the rock of my salvation. Forever, I will keep my steadfast love for him, and my covenant with him will stand firm. His line shall continue forever.
I'm done with the heart and the reason to wait.
I read the Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Jacob was the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, who is called the Christ. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with a child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man, and unwillingly to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you will name him Jesus, for he will save the people from their sins. When Joseph awoke from his sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
A reading from the Gospel according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Every year, the parents of Jesus went to Jerusalem for the festival of Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up, as usual, for the festival. When the festival ended and they started to return, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but his parents did not know it. Assuming that he was in the group of travelers, they went a day's journey. Then they started to look for him among their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem to search for him. After 3 days, they found him in a temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished, and his mother said to him, Child, why have you treated us like this? Look, your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety. He said to them, Why were you searching for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house? But they did not understand what he said to them. Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So I was really happy when Pope Francis designated this year to be the year of Saint Joseph. First of all, Saint Joseph runs in my family a little bit. So all the males on my dad's side of the family have Joseph as part of their middle name, including myself. But aside from the fact that he's kind of like an uncle figure to me, aside from the fact that he runs in my family, Saint Joseph is one of my favorite saints. He's one of my favorite saints. But the reasons I love Saint Joseph are, they might be a little different than what people might at first think. So first of all, I don't want to take anything away from Saint Joseph. Saint Joseph was a righteous man. The Bible says he was a righteous man, he was a virtuous man. He is an example, a great example, of a person who does the right thing despite being tempted to do the wrong thing. So he was faced with a temptation to do the wrong thing, and because of his strength of character, he said, I'm going to do the right thing. So in that, Joseph is a great example. But from a purely human perspective, it's difficult to say that Joseph would have actually made the best choice to be the foster father of Jesus. From a purely human perspective, from a logistical, practical point of view, because he kind of proved in the Bible that he wasn't all the greatest at making practical decisions. For example, when Mary was 9 months pregnant with Jesus, Joseph had the task of bringing Mary safely to Bethlehem, finding a proper room for her to give birth to Jesus, but he couldn't do that. He wasn't able to. We know what happened. They approached an inn, and the innkeeper said, "There's no room here." So Joseph couldn't find a proper room for Mary to give birth to Jesus in. And I get the fact that Bethlehem was crowded with people, but they could have left a little bit earlier. I can imagine the conversation that's going on between Joseph and Mary saying something like, "Joseph, couldn't we have left a little earlier, you know?" She might not have said that, but Joseph might have been thinking that. Why couldn't I just leave earlier? Why couldn't I make better arrangements for my wife, who is 9 months pregnant and needs to give birth to the Son of God? And then when she does give birth to Jesus, where do they end up? In a stable, in a barn. A stable is not a place you want to give birth in. I mean, in terms of the level of sanitation, the sanitation level, a stable is kind of like the equivalent to a dumpster nowadays. It's just not where you want to give birth to anyone. So I could just imagine Saint Joseph on that Christmas night, looking at the whole situation, the stable, the, you know, not being able to find a room, and just thinking to himself, "Man, is this the best I have to offer Jesus, the King of the universe? Is this the best I have to offer?" Here's another story of how Joseph may have been tempted to feel sorry for himself yet again. So when the Holy Family, so Joseph, Mary, and Jesus, this is when Jesus is 12 years old now, they're returning from Jerusalem back to their home in Nazareth. So Joseph is Jesus's father, his foster father. He had one job to do, to keep his eyes on his one son. And he couldn't do that because Jesus ends up going missing. I can imagine Joseph going through the caravan of people, of his relatives and friends, saying, "Have you guys seen Jesus? Yeah, I know I'm supposed to keep an eye on him and he's my only son and everything, but have you seen him? He's kind of lost." So a pretty embarrassing moment. So as you can see, Joseph wasn't perfect. He was a righteous man. He sought always to do the right thing, but he wasn't a perfect man. He wasn't Superman, at least in his ability to make practical decisions. But that's precisely why I love Saint Joseph. Here's the thing. Saint Joseph stuck around. Saint Joseph stuck around. He could have felt sorry for himself and said, "Forget this, I'm leaving. I'm not qualified for this. Certainly Jesus, the Son of God, deserves better than me, so I'm leaving." No, he didn't do that. Joseph stuck around. And because he stuck around, he proves that God is not limited by human weaknesses. He's not limited by our flaws. God is more than capable of using some of the most unqualified people to do some of his greatest work. In fact, God prefers to work that way. He prefers to use those who the world considers unequipped to do a certain job. Those are precisely the people God chooses to do some of his greatest tasks. Why does he do this? Because he wants to show the world that all the power and all the good things, ultimately those things come not from us, broken creatures that we are, but it ultimately comes from God. There's a saying that goes, God does not call the equipped, but he equips the called. In other words, God is not concerned about your skill set or lack of a skill set. All he wants to know, if you're willing to work with him, like Saint Joseph did, all he wants to know is if you're willing to stick around, as Saint Joseph did. And if you are, be prepared to see some pretty awesome things.
Saint Joseph was an ordinary man invited to participate in God's divine plan. He had many roles and went through many struggles, and for this reason, the Church invites us to use his life to reflect upon our own. Today, we bring our intentions to God through Saint Joseph. At the end of each intention, please respond with, "Lord, hear our prayer."
Saint Joseph, patron of families, guide and protect our families. Steer us away from spiritual and physical danger, as you did for Mary and the child Jesus. Help our families to grow in love, faith, patience, and service, as you modeled for us through your Holy Family. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
Saint Joseph, patron of workers, you undertook the difficult physical labor of a carpenter and a builder to provide for your family. You were faithful to your duties and persevered with integrity. Help us to persevere in whatever work God has given us to do each day, and intercede for all people who seek work to provide for their families. Bless workers around the world, that they will be paid a just and living wage, and that their human dignity will be honored before their productivity. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
Saint Joseph, patron of chastity and purity. Your purity of heart and body enabled God to trust you with the protection of Mary and the infant Jesus. Help us to live lives that are pure of heart, mind, and body so that we may love ourselves and others more perfectly. Bring healing to all those who suffer in their bodies, minds, and souls. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
Saint Joseph, patron of refugees. You were forced to flee to Egypt to protect the lives of your wife and child from the murderous King Herod. You know the pain of those who must flee from war, disaster, injustice, and poverty throughout the world. Hear the cries of those who seek refuge and guide them, as God guided you, to safety and new life. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
Saint Joseph, patron of the church and vocations, you serve Jesus our Lord with your whole life. Bless those priests and religious women and men who dedicate their lives to Jesus through his church. Bless them and all our spiritual leaders with every virtue and protect them in their vocations. Guide each one of us too, that we may know what God is calling us to do each day and have the wisdom and courage to do it. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
Saint Joseph, patron of good death, you are called upon for a peaceful and holy death, as you would have died in the arms of Jesus and Mary. Bring that same comfort to those who are dying and who are mourning for them. May their departed souls find mercy, peace, and eternal rest with their loving Father in heaven. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
We offer all our prayers to God, including those we carry in the silence of our hearts. We know that he hears them and will answer them in his perfect way and timing. As we listen to the following song, take a moment to offer the prayers you hold in your heart for your loved ones, your vocation, and the world.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many circles. can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call.
Hello, McGivney. Just a couple words I wanted to say. When it comes to the skills that you'll need in the future, the skills that you'll need to cultivate or develop now in order to face the unknown future and to have a happy life, a healthy family life, I think that skill is definitely adaptability, being flexible and adaptable. We're always asking you to look forward as students. So whether that's looking at future careers and educational pathways and things like that. But really, it's not just about looking forward. It's looking at who you are right now and thinking, am I a type of person right now who can face what comes in the future? So whatever challenge, whatever environment I'm thrown into, can I face that environment and can I survive in it? I always like the metaphor of the idea of a wall. You think, look, you hit a wall and you feel like you can't move forward, but you don't have to break down the wall. Accept the wall. Accept that it exists. It's there for a reason. Maybe it's a necessary pause that you needed to reflect on who you are in that moment. So those challenges feel like walls and obstacles, but really they're opportunities. So if you can find a way to accept that obstacle and sort of see it as something you can learn from, I think that's the best skill that you can have.
Many people today are scared of marriage. What is your response to that? Well, my parents are celebrating their 50th wedding anniversary this coming May. I mean, wow, that's my parents. My parents who would argue about every little thing every day, but yet somehow they made it to their 50th wedding anniversary. That's a great blessing. Marriage is not always going to be perfect. You need to understand there will be obstacles and sacrifices to be made, but you will overcome all that. Because with each challenge, the couple will learn more about themselves and with one another, and you will grow together throughout your marriage.
I think one thing that I can relate to with a lot of students at Father Michael McGivney is a similar upbringing. First generation Canadian born to Asian immigrant parents. Growing up, there was one very key and important goal to focus on: doing well in school. Life was always presented like stages, steps in life, which you could not move on to the next stage or step until you completed the previous one. Do well in school, get into a good university, get a good job, find a partner, marry that partner, have kids, etc. What I understand now that I did not understand in high school is that there are a few aspects of life where this mentality of succession works. For instance, like moving on from one stage in education to another, climbing the career ladder. The same process does not necessarily work when finding a life partner for marriage. You cannot force a person to fit into your life you have built for yourself simply because it is the right time in your life to do so. Timing does not equal compatibility.
From the moment we're able to realize our future, we start planning. Where am I going to be in 5, 10, 15 years? What will my life look like? I have the same plans as most of you do. Finish high school, university, get a job, and get married, start a family, all by the time I was 25. Big dreams and goals. But life will almost never go the way you plan despite your best efforts. But don't get me wrong, this in no way means disaster. It does, however, require changing our perspective and seeing our lives as a journey. One in which God is always walking alongside us, even if things might seem to spiral out of your control. I finished university getting my fancy degree, but as soon as I sat back down in my seat at convocation, I remember asking myself, now what? I checked off all the things I wanted to achieve, but everything after school was not clearly laid out. I soon ended up meeting the person I was going to marry. That was one thing checked off my plans. I got my first teaching job at McGivney right after, check again. So the next thing to focus on was starting a family. But here's where things started to fall apart, and my plan wanted to blow up in my face. After being married for a year, I was told that I could not have children, and the doctors could not give me an explanation. It was a deeply sad time in my life, and I asked God why this would happen to me. Wasn't this the path that I was supposed to take? Then why throw this obstacle in my face? A couple of years went by. Teaching became the most important thing that I could throw myself into because the busyness kept me distracted from the sadness of not being able to have my own children. It was in 2010, however, that my life was altered. Together with the chaplaincy team and some very passionate teachers and a group of three McGiffney students, I traveled to Kingston, Jamaica to volunteer at an orphanage for disabled children. The preparation and details required to plan the trip were all things that I loved doing, and the three students became my sole responsibility for the week of March break that they would be away from their own families. During our volunteer work, I remember going into the chapel attached to the orphanage and praying to God to give me what I most desired, a family of my own. And just when you think that God does not listen, I walked out of the chapel and the three students came running up to me asking, "Mama, where were you? We were looking for you." I was blown away. "What did you just call me?" They replied, "We've been calling you Mama ever since we left the airport in Toronto. You've been looking after us this whole time, so you're our mom for this week." I was stunned. Here I was wanting my life to go according to my plans, but God was helping me to see that my plan was still in play. I just needed to look at it from a different perspective. I could still be a parent. Every year, I had hundreds of new children whom I was called to treat like my own. I may not be able to have my own children, but every day there were children in my classroom that needed someone to love them, to be there for them, and to guide them. When I finally realized that our calling is to answer God's call to love no matter what happens in our lives, no matter what obstacles we face, we will always find our purpose. I realized that my vocation was to be who I wanted to be for everyone around me, to share my maternal instincts of caring and nurturing with the students in front of me. This has brought me more blessings than I could have ever imagined. When I taught grade 9 and had to teach students about the story of Abraham and Sarah not having any children, I used to feel sadness that the miracle of their story was not something that I would ever experience. It wasn't until after my experience of accepting that I could be a spiritual parent to hundreds of other students that I realized that God asked Abraham and Sarah to trust in God. God tells Abraham that he will have descendants that outnumber the stars. We can never see the stars that are up there, but we know that they're there. So my friends, know that your stars are out there. Trust that God will help you realize them if you trust in God and go where God guides you. My miracle did come to reality. After accepting that I could be a spiritual parent to my students, I am also now a parent to four of my own beautiful children, and it is the experience of being a parent to so many others before now that makes me a better parent and a better person every single day. God bless.
What's really intriguing about the parent-child relationship is that simultaneously, while your children grow and learn, they too are helping you learn, grow, and change. Children teach us about patience, perseverance, selflessness, unconditional love, and most of all, they teach us to appreciate the little things in life. As parents, we come to learn and realize that our children will not remember what kind of house they lived in, what type of clothes they wore, or how many toys they had, but they will remember the time we spend with them.
I think children are the most wonderful gift. I have three children, but I also had three miscarriages, so that was very hard. But my husband and I grew stronger, and it made me cherish each one of my children even more. They bring such joy that money can't buy. I think my children has taught me to be more loving, to be more patient, and more forgiving.
Hi everyone, it's Miss G, or Miss Gilmore, from the Arts Department, and I wanted to talk to you a little bit about my vocation as a teacher and a parent. I have a daughter, her name is Eileen, and she's 4 years old, and she is both the joy and the challenge of my life. On one side, I really miss sleep. I struggle with lack of sleep, but the good things about being a parent far outweigh the challenges. All of a sudden, your priority shift. It's not just all about you. You're now focusing on this human being, and you want to support them and help them grow. And maybe, you know, your hobbies and your pursuits, you don't get to do that as much, but you get to discover new things, new hobbies, and share them with your child. And finally, in terms of being a teacher, I think being a parent has helped me become a better teacher because I've become more empathetic. And I stop and think about, how would I want my child to be treated? What if that person were my child? You know, how can I help them? How can I help pick them up when they fall? How can I support them in their goals? So just a little shout out to all our students and my, you know, current as well as past students. We miss you. We are all in this together in this pandemic. It's hard to not see you in person and be able to talk to you and find out how you're doing. We're thinking about you. We're worried about you. And we're here to support you. Take care, everybody.
Hey guys, hope you enjoyed that liturgy. Unfortunately, it had to happen this way. Hopefully in the near future, I get to visit you guys in person. But until then, if you have any other questions, you want to continue the conversation, feel free to get a hold of me. Ms. Selva Kumar has my email. Drop me a line. It'd be great to hear from you. Until then, though, may Almighty God bless you through the intercession of Saint Joseph. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless.
As we bring this time of prayer to a close, we want to thank Father Matt, our wonderful staff, and the many amazing students from SLAM who shared their time and talents with us, both on camera and behind the scenes. We hope that the time we've spent together will encourage you to keep thinking deeply about who you are and what God is calling you to. We encourage you to talk to those who know you best and can call out what is good in you. Seek out faith leaders who can help you to see yourself as God sees you. Of course, we hope you know that you can always reach out to your chaplaincy team for conversation, support, prayers, or resources. We leave you today with some suggestions that might be of help to you on this journey. God bless McGivney.
To let it all go. Yeah, I see it now. I'm laying it down. And I know that I need you. Run to the Father. I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding. No reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon. My soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again. Redemption, the price for my heart. And I don't have a contact for that kind of love.